Welcome to Let It Fly Show, taping live in Las Vegas, Nevada. I am Michael Sevier, joined by former Jay Josh Jones, following Creighton falling to BYU, 83-80. Valiant comeback by the Jays, but it wasn't enough. BYU holds on. Jays fall to 6-4. Lots to talk about with this game. Lots to talk about the show overall, but it really was a great fight by the Jays, but right. They just couldn't overcome the offensive rebounds, man.
Right, exactly. I mean, we honestly played our game, so to speak, from three today. We didn't shoot that well from two, man, but yeah. You know what my favorite part of the game was?
What?
The 10 seconds backcourt call.
Oh, that was great defense, yeah.
Because, I mean, we've watched our, the Jays play three times in a row.
Yep.
And they fell short. In each and every game, I just think aggression is not questioning toughness. It's all about aggression on defense.
Yep. So they were, the score was 79-68 with 3:26 left.
Right.
Jays then forced five turnovers, including the 10-second violation you mentioned, got to 80-79 with a lead with 26 seconds left. It comes down to a missed shot by BYU, a putback by BYU to take the lead, and then the ball gets shifted over to the corner to Sharif Mitchell. It was just a little short
right.
for the three, comes up short, ends up losing the game. Sometimes the fight to come back takes so much out of you to come back, you don't have that finishing kick to finish it.
Right.
And that's kind of what happened tonight.
I mean, the rebounds.
Yeah, rebounds incredible.
The rebounds were incredible. I mean, if you look at,
it was 50 to 29.
That is
50 to 29. It's remarkable. And then offensive rebounds, 16 to 4.
Man,
that's just getting beat hustle wise on the boards.
And
that's
the thing is, I know Kaluma fouled out.
He did, and he fouled out early too. He fouled out with 6:32.
Right.
Got his fourth foul with 8:30 left. Came back in the game, had a turnover, and then fouled trying to get the ball back. And then fouled out with 6:32 to remain. And we mentioned, we'll say this now off the air.
Right.
They got BYU into the penalty early, right? The bonus. They had like 11 minutes and 30 seconds left. From there on, Creighton was shooting free throws. You should think, okay, you got it in the bag now. And that's when BYU went on their run.
Exactly. Mm. And the thing is, like, you can't really, like, it's just tough.
Yeah.
It's just a tough situation. BYU scored 60 points in a game against Utah Valley.
They did.
And lost by 15.
Yep.
Toughness, but through aggression defensively.
Now, I will say, if you don't know, Ryan Kalkbrenner did not play in the game.
Right.
You're talking about the defending Big East defensive player of the year. So you're missing the guy inside. You understand that. In the first half, BYU shot 50% from the field.
Right.
50% from the field. Didn't shoot great from three, but overall they got the ball in the paint. In the paint, they had more points than Creighton did by, I think it was 20. You're in the paint was, 42 to 24. So 18-point difference in the paint. A big part of that is not having Kalkbrenner in there.
Well, it's you don't panic.
Sure.
Like, you got to – the season's not over.
No.
It's
a long way to go.
The team is 6-4.
Yep.
But it's one of those things where people are excited about this Jays team simply because of the roster.
Yeah.
And that's from top to bottom. Mm-hmm. So do you ask yourself, if you're Coach McDermott, do you say, maybe I got to make adjustments? Not saying that I got to change the starter, but maybe kind of balance out some of the starters' minutes or some of the guys off the bench or things like that. It's like, what do you do? You got to give guys a chance. When they had that 10-second call backcourt, the reserves were on the floor, I believe, along with Trey Alexander.
Yep.
It was electrifying. I seen fans standing up from the 2-minute mark all the way down until the end.
Yep.
We made some mistakes and couldn't execute. But, you kind of got to have guys step up.
Dude, bench points, 38-8.
Wow.
38, that's depth by BYU. A team that was struggling with their depth, with their bench scoring, scored 38 points on their bench.
And I'll go back to the same explanation I just made again. You gotta have reserve step up.
Yep.
You gotta be aggressive defensively. Mm-hmm. We live and die by threes, that's our identity for sure.
Yep.
Shooters need shots and we gonna keep on shooting.
Yep.
We actually shot well, like I mentioned today.
10 of 27 from three is not horrible.
Right.
37%.
But it's the fight.
Yeah.
It's like Coach Mack, excellent coach. He and his staff, we went by practice a bit yesterday.
Yep.
He had them as prepared as they can be.
I thought so, yep.
It's not on him. Mm-hmm. It comes from within, from the team.
Yep. Coming up on a Let It Fly show here taping in Vegas, Michelob Ultra Arena, another game coming up after us. We are going to have Trey Alexander on the show, the Oklahoma City native. He'll chat about the game with us. We're also going to get into some Nebraska stuff because, of course, big story this week was defensive coordinator getting hired, offensive line coach being retained. We'll get into that stuff as well. Nebraska played an incredible game today against Purdue. They fell short as well. Creighton lost, Nebraska lost, and Omaha lost.
Man.
All three of the local teams fell. Division One teams fell today. We'll talk about all that as well. But we come back to Vegas. Our show also brought to you by Omaha Steaks. We appreciate them being part of this. And the Let It Fly Bar, which will be open Memorial Day down in the Capital District as well.
Can't
so we want to appreciate all that. I can't wait either.
Yeah.
A lot of people here today, part of the Let It Fly Sports Bar, talking about it, having fun here in this suite. We're looking forward to having it down there. We'll have the whole little bit, the little pin for us.
Yeah, right.
Glassed in, doing our podcast as well. We appreciate Herd At Media for producing this for us. Pat Safford and Sasha Durkin taking care of that as well. But you look back at this game overall, and we can talk about hustle, and we can talk about effort and all that stuff. Arthur Kaluma played a great game, coming off a game where he had 0 points.
Right.
He was the offense tonight.
You seen it in his eyes.
Mm-hmm.
I remember when he came on the previous game against Nebraska.
Yeah.
I seen he took accountability in that moment. Mm-hmm. It wasn't about himself. He stepped up as much as he could.
Yeah.
He played hard. That's half of the reason why he fouled out.
Yeah.
I mean, you can always say some calls are questionable on he is a player or maybe the refs, but I thought Arthur Kaluma played great today.
He played only 26 minutes because of the foul trouble, but he was 4 of 7 from three.
Yep.
And by the way, early, before the game started, we saw him come out here warm up twice. They came out the first time just, you know, before everything got started. And then came out a second time. I swear, he only missed like three threes. He was killing
it
before the game. He was locked in. 4 of 7 from three, 7 of 11 from the field. And
right.
We mentioned he had 27 points going to the free throw line 11 times as well and making 7 of those. So he played his heart out. And then you don't have Ryan Kalkbrenner, which changes the way you're going to do a lot of things. When you look at not having Ryan Kalkbrenner in the lineup, what's the biggest, other than the defensive side, give me the offensive side, what's the biggest difference in this team when he's not in the lineup?
Well, when he's not in the lineup, it gives offensive teams, when we're on the defensive end, an opportunity to be aggressive to the basket.
Mm-hmm.
Like you mentioned today, the offensive rebound at the end is what put the nail in the coffin.
It did. Yep.
They put pressure on us. They drove the ball. They moved the ball around. And they got second chance points.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's not even about hitting shots. All you got to do is get the rebound and put it back in.
What about offensively? How does it change what Creighton does when Kalkbrenner's not playing?
Offensively, I feel like it gives the guards an initial flow. I thought that is half of the reason why Kaluma had a better game today. Without the presence of Kalkbrenner, it allowed him an opportunity to have more space and flow for himself to see and gain his confidence back.
Yeah,
You got to have a yin and yang, and that's nothing against obviously Kalkbrenner, but like he saw he had to step up in some type of manner.
Yeah,
and without his presence, that's what the results of Kaluma competing hard today was for.
We also needed Bud Crawford to get his fight over with
early
so we could talk about it on this podcast. And with about 2 minutes left in the basketball game, he did it. 6-round knockout. Little uppercut first and then a check hook. Wasn't even a full hook, and he knocked him out. Evasana went down. Looked like he was out for a second. Stayed down. Bud wins. Now 39-0.
Man.
Truly one of the least top three pound-for-pound guys in the world. And now it's Errol Spence Jr. That's what they'll be calling for. But it was nice of Bud to end it early for us.
No, for sure. Yeah. I mean, it's one of those things. Bud is in a class of his own.
Yeah.
And you know, actually watching the fight, I felt like we have to give more credit to David Avanesian because, I mean, I know people say, oh, who is he? Nobody knows about him. He put up a better fight than what we all expected.
Yeah, he did.
So kudos to him for sure for doing that. But at the end of the day, before this fight, I was thinking when I woke up this morning, like, I tell you what, it reminds me of an episode of Martin Lawrence on The Martin Show.
Okay, Martin!
Yeah, there was an episode where Tommy Hitman Hearns was on.
Yeah.
And he played cameo, and he was hitting on Gina.
Okay.
Martin walked in the room and was offended, and he walked up to him, and he challenged him to a two-round fight.
What? Okay, against Tommy Hearns. Okay.
Martin Lawrence.
The Hitman.
Yes.
Okay, all
Martin right. Lawrence ended up looking like he had 1,000 bee stings. And no Benadryl for the allergic reaction.
Yeah, that's very
all
true,
types of lumps on his face.
Yeah.
I was thinking, like, Bud has to go into this ring.
Yep.
He has to mop the guy, you know, mop the floor with the guy and show Spence just to say, This is what you're going to get.
Right.
But watching the fight, actually, it shows that it's not just really about Bud being a slow starter and downloading things. Mm-hmm. It's just more so about that's just his style.
Yeah, yeah.
And so it's not like it's not a bad thing for him to be a slow starter, and I don't think mm-hmm. that'll be his disadvantage against Spence. But
what's tough for Bud is that he is measured against his own greatness.
Exactly.
When guys are great.
Oh, like, man.
Michael Jordan's the guy you can always throw around.
Yep.
And you'd go, oh, dude, he only had 26 tonight.
Right.
You know, he was only like 11 for 30 from the field. And you're like, but you're measuring against greatness. Bud is so good that no matter how well he fights, he's always going to get measured against how good he could be.
Yes.
Until he fights a big name, and everybody's going to go, he isn't fighting anybody. Until he fights Errol Spence Jr., and takes care of him,
right?
Then people will finally give him credit. And he's not the only boxer.
No.
I can go back as far as you want to go to guys who've... Larry Holmes, one of the greatest heavyweight fighters of all time, was constantly talked about, well, he didn't have Frazier to go against, and he didn't have Norton, who he actually beat for the title. He didn't have any of these people in their prime. Well, Bud can only fight who will get in the ring with him.
That's
and
it.
Everybody that's got... Victor Postol, they said, right. Oh, Victor Postol's going to control him with his jab. Did he control him with his jab? No, he did not.
No,
every
exactly.
guy that gets in the ring with Bud, they're like, he's going to do this, he's going to do this. Well, he hasn't.
Right.
And Bud is always going to be measured against his own greatness, what makes it difficult for him.
Exactly. Yeah. And that's why I think that is great for Bud. No matter what people say, he stays true to himself.
He does. He does.
And
oh, yeah.
And that is why I think he'll always be successful. He does
that's
not
why,
care.
That's why he came out to My Prerogative.
Yeah.
Because it is his prerogative to do whatever he wants to do.
Exactly.
Right? He didn't want to be anymore with Top Rank. He wanted to go on his own.
Right.
He's trying out this thing. He's supposedly going to get a bunch of money for this pay-per-view.
Right.
We'll see what it ends up being for him. $10 million is the number that was thrown out there. But he's doing it his own way.
Yeah.
That's fine. And a lot of guys have.
Floyd
did it. Obviously, did it his own way.
Oh my God!
Right, Golden
the
Boy.
Ultimate example.
Golden Boy started his own promotion company so he'd keep the money in his house. Right?
Right.
So a lot of guys have done it this way. Bud's trying to do it this way to make up for the money he lost out with Top Rank. But in order to make this fight,
and I
think it's really going to happen sometime in February or March of next year.
I say May.
You think that long?
I think that long.
Because that means another 6 months, well, 5 months of him sitting out.
Yeah, but after like mid-May, because
I
you
did
know-
see that Errol Spence had another car accident today.
Really?
Like he, yeah. Like I don't think it was a really bad one, but
right.
like somebody, I might have misread this, but it, like his mom's car got stolen, and then he was chasing the guy and hit him. Or I don't.
Man.
Maybe I misread that, but that's what I was seeing today.
Yeah, I hope everything's okay with Spence.
Yeah.
But I hate when things happen building up to the fight because that's anything to fuel an excuse.
Oh, I know. Yeah.
You know, I we don't want any excuses at all. I hope he's all right though. If that is the case.
Yeah. So he apparently survived another car crash. He was on Instagram Live saying he's okay.
Yeah.
He says he was hit by a 14-year-old who ran a red light.
Wow.
Yeah, which that 14-year-old shouldn't be driving.
Yeah, right.
Based off of the laws.
Oh, man.
But a 14-year-old ran a red light. He's okay, though. So that's
good,
that's good to know because that last accident he had was very scary. So we got Bud Crawford winning.
Yeah. Was it a 6-round check hook?
See, yeah, he caught him. It was like a little mini uppercut, which I think that's what stunned him.
Yeah, I was trying to multitask.
And then the check hook took him out.
Right.
That's one of Bud's best punches.
Yeah.
Because it's so quick. It's not a full, but he's had heavy hand. He's a heavy-handed
dude.
He is. Like, if you hug him and he pats you, or he's just a heavy-handed guy.
No,
you people like that.
No, exactly.
And that's what he is. You know?
Exactly.
And he's got the long arms.
Yeah.
And because of that, with his weight, he can be able to keep you away from him and everything. But, yeah, Bud's just an excellent fighter, man. There's no other way to say that.
Yeah, shout out to Omaha.
Yeah.
Shout out to Bud. Congrats to the champ.
Yep. And everybody says it was a good crowd there.
Yeah, for sure.
It was a really nice crowd there. Again, coming up on the show, we're going to chat with Trey Alexander. We'll get him up here. We're up in the suite in the Michelob Ultra Arena. And we had an earlier game. Cal State Fullerton lost to Southern Utah. Now we got another game coming up after this.
Right.
I think we need to be done before that because I don't know if we can be doing this while they're doing
the
game.
Get us out of here in the suite.
This is a brand new tournament they're doing.
Uh-huh.
And it's interesting because, you know, not a lot of big name teams.
Yeah.
Obviously, Creighton's ranked, and they'll probably stay ranked now. BYU's not. Arizona State, we know what they do under Bobby Hurley. But then you got like a Southern Utah and a Utah State.
Yeah.
Not really big name. Across town, they had Arizona. What was
I've seen a lot of Indiana
Indiana and
around.
Arizona,
right.
Big teams there,
right.
But it's a cool little tournament, and they're hoping to keep doing this.
Yeah.
I thought it was the JJ Hoop Fest. I thought it was for you, man.
Oh, my God.
I thought it was for you.
Yeah, somebody said the name Jones, and I was like, I'm not doing anything.
It's not doing it.
I wish,
It said hashtag JJ Hoop Fest. I was like, well, that's obviously Josh Jones Hoop Fest is what that is. So we'll talk to Tyson Alexander once he gets up here. Trey Alexander, excuse me. You know, I always
Tyson,
do that in my
I
mind.
Feel you.
I always
feel you.
Think that way. Obviously, Tyshawn's in the league.
Right.
And Trey Alexander's here. Didn't have a awesome game, but, you know, he played hard. Yeah. He got to the free throw line. Trey Alexander did 12 times.
Right.
10 of 12 from the free throw line. And when you know this, your shot's not going in, get to the line.
And
take them free points.
And that is what we've been preaching about him.
Yep.
He's somebody who I appreciate because he's a stat packer.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
I looked at his high school stats.
Yeah.
And he was a 20-plus scorer every year, but also almost a double-double guy, along with steals. I'm talking about two to four.
Oh, wow.
Like, I mean, with his frame and with his motor, he's long. Mm-hmm. Yep. So, like, you – with a loss like this, I mean, it was great that he came along at the end offensively to keep us tight and keep us in it.
Yeah.
But I feel like he's the guy that can be accountable to set the tone for that aggression that I was talking about defensively.
He ended up having four assists, one steal. He had three rebounds. We mentioned he had 17 points, 12 of which came through the free throw line. But if you're not getting your shot off, you go to the free throw line, get your points. Now, Billy Shireman only had 13, didn't shoot well, 3 of 11. He only got the free throw line 6 times, so he was 5 of 6. Ended up with, like I said, 13 points. But we mentioned the bench. Really nothing off the bench. 8 points off the bench.
Right.
Makes it tough.
And the thing was, when the bench was in the game at that point when they did the press and they got that 10 seconds,
yep.
It doesn't even – we want the bench to step up, but if we just keep that intensity throughout the whole game, we don't even have to press as a team. I mean, Creighton can just honestly just put pressure and slow the tempo down and then, more so just be aggressive with active hands on the ball as it's playing half court.
I don't care how many times and how old I get. When someone says be aggressive, I just want to spell it. I'm just like, I so many cheerleaders over the years with the be aggressive. But, yeah, you're right. There was a time, and I even tweeted this out, like, I think it was still in the first half, where I said, they're winning all the hustle points.
Every one of them, man.
I remember when I was growing up, I used to go see Tulane play, a little Fogelman Green Arena, a little tiny arena in New Orleans, and they had a hustle board.
They had
the regular scoreboard and a hustle board. And the hustle board always had, like, block shots, steals, like they had burns. It was like getting on the floor.
Yeah.
And they had them all marked down. And that's what they were doing. They were getting on the floor.
And I only say we to the people out there.
No, I understand. You played there, dude. You was honestly we.
It's hard not to say we because, I was once in the locker room.
Yeah.
But just objectively speaking, Creighton needs to be aggressive.
Yep. Yeah, especially against Arizona State's coming in. They're 9-1. Now, their overall stats aren't great. They haven't played a lot of great teams, but they are 9-1. And I don't – you think they'll have Kalkbrenner? I don't think so.
Yeah. I mean, just see him yesterday. I feel like he was doing better.
Yeah.
Not well enough to come back. I mean, anytime you're going through any type of sickness or whatever, it's hard for your immune system. You want to get a weakened condition and at least to come back.
Yeah, and there's some conditions – we're not trying to give anything away, but there's some conditions where you can't physically play because your organs could be damaged by what you're doing. So I'm just saying that's a possibility.
Right.
But like he, obviously was at practice, kind of standing off to the side.
High spirits, though.
Yeah, they need him back for Arizona State.
What do you think about Freddie King today on his first start?
Now, listen, so he only had 4 points. Scored actually the first 2 points of the game.
Yeah.
But he was an intimidating force when he was in there.
Right.
Blocking shots, making people alter their shots. He's just so raw.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking.
He's really raw.
He's just one of those guys where you really can't look at his stats. I mean, it's nerve-wracking when you get that big start like that for the first time. You got to look at his effort. And I feel like he played as hard as he could. I mean, obviously, he made some errors just off of him not being comfortable in that consistent starting position. Yeah. But it's a lot. The ceiling is high. It's a lot to build off of. He's very athletic.
Yep.
He's a dog. He plays hard.
Yeah.
And I think he can also be that guy that can set the tone aggressively.
Now, plus minus is not the end all be all. We know that.
Yes.
We know that. But so Frederick King was only in the game 18 minutes.
Right.
His plus minus was minus 16.
Oh.
Yeah. So your other ones were Farabella was minus 9 and Mason Miller was minus 8. So essentially your normal guys on the bench, coming off the bench, were really bad plus minus wise. He had 3 block shots, King did, but he altered probably 3 or 4 other ones.
Yeah.
And again, scored the 4 points. You can see in a year down the, and I know he's not going to shoot a 3 like him, but I always remember when Anthony Tolliver got here.
Yeah.
Anthony Tolliver got here, and I mean, I thought of, he wasn't, didn't like he was in the greatest shape when he first got here, right?
Yeah.
Didn't like to me. And I remembered going out to the trail, which is not too far from where my house, and watching him run during the offseason.
Really?
This was a guy that was out there running on the trail. There's a little trail coming up from Alex Arbin.
Okay.
And he'd be out there, and he'd run. I'd see him out there sweating. I'd be riding my bike past him. And by his second year, he was running up and down the court.
Yeah.
Then he started hitting threes.
Yeah.
And you're like, whoa, look at this.
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden, he made a 13-year career out of it.
Yeah.
So I'm not saying Frederick King's going to be that. But we have seen in this program big men develop.
For sure.
So hopefully.
Yeah, it's one of those things where some guys' DNA is hard work.
Oh, yeah.
And that is Freddie King to me when I see him.
Yeah.
Hard work.
You had, I mentioned BYU coming into the game.
Yep.
They were without one of their better starters. And they've been without him for 5 games now.
Yep.
And so he was one of the leading scorers, Spencer Johnson, when he went out. But BYU was averaging 15 turnovers coming in this game, which is not good.
No.
And they ended up turning the ball over 20 times. So they didn't get away. They didn't shoot the ball great.
Yeah.
Creighton shot better than they had shooting from three.
BYU also struggles to guard the three-point line anyway.
Yeah, all of those things they did. So it really wasn't any of the main numbers. It was purely offensive rebounds.
Yeah, which is
get on
crazy.
The board, man. Get on the boards. That's what the difference in this game was. And you look at Nembhard, who played his heart out.
Yeah.
Flying all over the place, diving on the ground. In terms of bench points, and we mentioned only 8 points, who is the person off the bench you think needs to step up the most?
Good question.
And eventually it will be Frederick King because he won't be starting when Kalkbrenner is in the starting lineup. But outside of maybe Frederick King, who do you need to step up?
Sharif Mitchell.
There's no doubt about that.
Sharif, I just got to keep it real.
I mean, he's a third-year player now.
The thing. Like, you're a seasoned vet. Mm-hmm. You actually do play hard defensively.
Oh, there's no doubt. He's a great defender.
You know, but when things like – how should I put it? I feel like Sharif always is going to bring his best effort defensively. Mm-hmm. He's always going to try to execute the offense. We need him to drive to the basket some and get to the free throw line too.
I like to see that. He only played 7 minutes.
Yeah, and you got a question, like, what is it? What is it to? Is it due to lack of offensive production in moments? You know, is it due to I just got a kind
of
question.
He had the same amount of minutes as Schultzberg, Ben did. Same amount of minutes. They both had 7 minutes. Neither one of them scored. They both were 0 for 2 from the field.
Yeah, and so to me, I feel like Sharif being a seasoned vet, just being a vet alone, you got to take more accountability.
Yeah.
You know, and I'm not trying to, bash him by any means at all.
No, I know, man. You know? But he's
very capable.
Yeah, we know
and
he
so
is.
So I got to hold him to that standard.
We've seen him Sharif be Mitchell. Good. Offensively,
right.
Not necessarily shoot the three, but like you said, get to the rack, maybe get fouled.
For sure.
He's a good finisher. He's always been a good finisher at the rack.
For sure.
So.
And it's one of those things where even if you don't take the shot, you can penetrate and you can have the defenders collapse and kick.
Yep.
I mean, Baylor Shireman is a great shooter.
Great, yep. Yep.
And those driveway jump shots, you know, those can be key.
Yeah.
But he just got to make more happen. The thing that I think that I like about when I think about Nembhard, you spoke about him a little earlier. Every time he has the ball, he puts pressure on the defense offensively. It's like he almost always tries to get a paint touch. It's not like he's looking to get a shot, but he makes the defense stop him before he makes a reactive play.
He only had 11 points, but he had 7 assists.
See what I'm saying?
And 5 rebounds.
You see what I'm saying? And Sharif is very capable. We've seen him do it. And I know he's been through a lot of adversity. You know, he was injured for sure.
Yep.
And for him to come back and be able to play now,
you
know, and do it at a high level, I commend him. But the accountability as a seasoned vet, man, you got to step up.
Let me tell you, as a guy who was injured a lot in my life, a guy who's going to be having knee replacement surgery next week, when you have a groin injury like he had, it's always – because I've been injured a lot.
Man.
I've broken bones. I've torn ligaments. I tore my shoulder up. When you have that groin injury, it's always like you know if I take the wrong step, it can happen again. And it gets in your mind. I'm not saying that's hurting him right now.
Yeah.
But groin is one of the worst injuries you could have.
I know.
And you can't really do anything when you have the groin injury.
Yeah. And,
so
I've talked to Sharif about that.
Yeah.
It was all psychological,
it
too.
It is. It really is.
Because you can tweak it, but then you can pull it if you come back too early. There's so many things about it.
And that's what he ended up doing last year.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And the thing that I'll say also about Sharif is this. He's obviously showing Coach Mack something because Coach Mack has kept him in the same position in that lineup and rotation because he believes in him.
Right.
And I feel like that just shows that it's okay to put that ceiling high for Sharif because you've seen him do it before.
Yeah.
And we believe in him for sure, and he just has to step up.
We're hoping to get Trey Alexander up here to chat with him about the game. But in the meantime, big news from this week was Tony White, new defensive coordinator under Matt Rhule, comes from Syracuse. The big debate now is...
It's a trick bag, bro.
3-3-5.
Yeah.
And what works or what doesn't work. So I was in New Mexico when Rocky Long was in New Mexico. And Rocky Long is one of the true originators of the 3-3-5. He didn't invent it, but he modified it and did a lot of things.
Yeah.
And what I always tell people is, don't worry about whatever the name of the defense is.
Right.
Because in football, especially when you have a Nebraska schedule, you have to stop multiple times of offense, right?
Yeah.
So, like, for example, you play in Oklahoma.
Uh-huh.
Going to spread you out fast, maybe not that big, not that physical.
Yeah.
You're also in the same season. You have to play a team like Michigan. Big, physical, and running right at you.
Right.
Play a team like Purdue. Again, wants to spread out against you. Then you're going to play Minnesota. So you got to play a bunch of different ones.
Yep.
The 3-3-5 is just what they call their base. Okay, that's just their base.
So it's like a zone.
It's not necessarily a zone.
Okay.
So what they do is it's a third guy who is essentially a safety. You can call him a rover. At New Mexico, they called him a Lobo.
Okay. Okay.
At San Antonio,
okay.
At San Diego State, they call him an Aztec.
I understand.
Here, they might call him, I don't know, a Husker. But you got that rover position. And what you do is those guys all move together.
Yeah.
When you got like two wide receivers, you're 2-by-1, you move one of those safeties over, and then the rover comes with them. It allows you to be able to be very versatile. Here's the thing you have to have. Above everything else, yes, whoever's playing rover, and that's going to be a good discussion on who it becomes from Nebraska's roster now, but you got to have two good defensive tackles.
Yeah.
Those defensive tackles will sometimes be head up over the center, so that nose tackle is there. Sometimes they'll be a bare front, which is over the center and the two guards, and sometimes they're going to be all the way over to the strong side and allow your pass rusher to be free to the other. We're going to see all kinds of things.
Yeah.
When it's third and two in the game, Josh, we're not going to see what we would see on first and 10.
Right.
Trust me. This guy, let me show you what he's done. So he came to Syracuse. The defense was horrible.
Uh-huh.
The best defense they had at Syracuse under the current coaching staff was 98th.
Wow.
Here's what he did last year in his fourth year. They allowed 3.335 points per play. It's a much better metric, in my opinion, than just saying, here's how many points a game, right?
Yeah,
points
right.
Because some teams go really, really fast, and they have 80 points, 80 plays, and some other have 60. So I like it that way.
Yep.
Now, that's versus FBS. I always take the FCS schools out. That's 38th in the country.
Yep.
They went from not being in the top 100 the majority of the years to being 38th.
30-something, yeah,
giving up 4.9 yards per play. Okay, that ranked 29th. So now you're top 30 in a stat involving scoring.
And you were once 98th.
And you were once either 98th or in the 100s.
And this is the thing about it, though. So I was kind of trying to look into it myself.
Yep.
And one of the things that I guess he calls it the mob defense.
Yep.
And it's like unpredictably aggressive.
Mm-hmm. What you want? What's a mob do? A mob doesn't beat you at one guy.
Right, they gang up on
you. A mob is a collective.
Exactly.
Yep.
And so the thing is, with the circumstances of the Huskers, it's almost like our fans could – I feel like our fans are a little bit torn. It's like, cool story, bro, because he's not a big – it's not a Deion Sanders.
Well,
you know, it's not one of those.
Yeah.
But credit to Matt Rhule, you got to give him the benefit of the doubt because he's obviously seen it before when he was probably at UCLA or something like that, you know?
Yeah, well, this kid played at UCLA.
Okay.
But he didn't play when Matt Rhule was there.
Okay.
But – so this is what happens – you want to get guys who come from the origination of something.
Makes sense.
He was there at the beginning of the 3-3-5 as a player.
Right.
Then later, Rocky Long was like, hey, you want to come coach with me? He went and coached at two different places with Rocky Long. Then he goes to Syracuse because the head coach wanted somebody from Rocky Long's coaching tree.
In the original culture.
He wanted that guy.
Understood.
And he said, Tony White, you're my guy.
Right.
He brought Tony White in, who had never called a defense before, and said, I'm giving it all over to you. And he turned it around. Against the past, they were 24th last year.
Yeah.
And against the run, they were 54th. That's not horrible.
Yeah.
When you're really good at one, the other one's going to always drop off. If people can't throw against you, they're just going to try to run against you
right.
more. And so he was pretty good overall. Here's the funny thing about this. When you go back and look at some of the best years Nebraska's defense, I mentioned earlier, 0.335 points per play is what Syracuse gave up in the ACC last year. The last time Nebraska had that good of points per play was 2009.
Wow.
When they led the nation at .149.
Yeah.
None of Bo's other defenses were that low.
Yeah.
Banker's best was right there.
Yeah.
And Chin's best, which was last year, was right there as well. But this is as good, at least when you're talking about points per play,
right.
as they've had since Bo early on.
I mean, it's hard. It's something to get excited about.
It is. I think so.
I mean,
I know it's the Big Ten.
Yeah.
I get that.
Exactly.
Trust me, he will adjust
yeah.
to what he has to
for
do
sure.
in the Big
yeah,
Ten.
Yeah, that was what I was about to say.
Yeah.
And so, no, I mean, everything you said kind of put it in perspective for me. I never was against it. I just thinking from a perspective of the Husker faithful.
Yes.
I know he's not as... You know,
that's
prominent, like
name.
I said.
Right.
But at the end of the day,
yeah.
you got to give him a chance.
Well, they wanted Jim Leonard. Jim Leonard, who decided last week that he was going to leave. Well, actually, I think it was Thursday, where he said, I'm not going back to Wisconsin.
Right.
I'll coach the bowl game and go somewhere else. I was like, well, maybe we'll get Jim Leonard, who is a pretty good defensive coordinator. That's what I thought.
Yeah.
But you know what? You're not going to always get what you want.
No, exactly.
The guy they. So I asked people on Twitter.
Okay.
Because I mentioned the Lobo or the Rover position.
Yeah,
right?
I wonder what
I said, who do you think? That's on the roster now would fit that position. I gave him a couple examples. When I was at New Mexico, the Lobo position was Brian Urlacher, who's a big dude. Right?
Of
he was about 235 at the time while he was there. Yes. Run, could play. This is a guy. This is how athletic Brian Urlacher was.
Okay.
On offense, when New Mexico got in the red zone, they played him at tight end.
Yeah.
Late in games when he needed a big play, they put him back to return punts.
That's ridiculous,
exactly.
bro.
I was at a game where he blocked the punt, returned a punt, and caught a touchdown the same game.
That's crazy.
He's crazy. So I asked, you know, who's the guy on the roster now you think could be the guy to play the Rover position?
Okay.
And I threw out a guy like Jake Applegate.
Yeah.
Who is a very good athlete.
Yeah.
Played offense and defense in high school. People are saying, like, Jalel Martin
okay.
and Javon Wright. You got two guys who are both long and very athletic. Now, Martin, I'm almost afraid for that guy to be starting in the defense. He talks so much on special teams. I'm worried that if he got on defense, he would have all kind of special teams, all kind of personal fouls.
Yeah.
Seth Malcolm is an interesting guy. He was an eight-man player who was very athletic.
Yep.
Phelan Sanford, who is a great athlete.
Yep.
Not as long as I would like at that position. But a bunch of different guys on here. Javon Wright is one of the most consistent ones in terms of what people said. Another guy saying again, that's Buda Wright, who is long. He's about 6'3", but got really long arms, really good athletes, been injured a lot. But there's a lot of guys, a lot of guys who could fit in this system.
And as you're naming that, it's like, look at the potential that Tony White has with the defense that he's bringing in.
Yep.
I'm excited.
The only question mark is, and you've already lost most likely Ernest Hausman, who's a runaround tackle guy, which is great. I think you're going to lose Garrett Nelson. I don't know.
Yeah.
So that's one of your pass rushers. O'Shawn Mathis is going to leagues. You lose your other one.
Yeah.
And then you thought you were going to lose Jamari Butler, but Jamari Butler changed his mind, got back out of the portal. He's coming.
Yeah.
So that's good. Here's the thing. I mentioned those two defensive tackles. Your two other guys, they're not necessarily rush-ins, they're not necessarily outside linebackers, but they're your two outside guys.
Right.
Sometimes they're a big defensive lineman-sized guy. Sometimes they are an outside linebacker who's like 215.
Yep.
I don't think that Garrett Nelson's that guy. He can't drop.
I don't know.
I think Jamari Butler can.
Right. Yeah.
But you're going to have to get more people in here. The other guy you have is Gunderson, Blaze Gunderson.
Yep.
I don't know if Blaze, he's a 6'5", 250.
Okay.
I don't know if he quite fits into that, but he's going to have to kind of rebuild his front.
Yeah.
I think the linebackers can play.
Yeah.
I think his front's going to have to rebuild a little
bit. Now, do you think that he would just roll with who already had the spot from last season?
I think all spots are open. I think Nash Hutmacher is a guy, who, when they're lining up with that tackle right over the nose, right over the center, I think he's good there.
And that's
good. All you got to do is give push. Now, next to him, I think there's a variety of guys who could be next to him, but that's, if they're not going to get somebody out of the portal, that's the place they got to build.
Understood.
They got to build
make
that
a lot of
line.
Sense. 100% make a lot of sense.
And then on the other side of the line of scrimmage, the offensive line.
Yep.
You thought people were mad about Tony White.
Oh, my God. You're talking about
They keep Donovan Raiola. Which, if there was a position that was weak on the team, it was the offensive line.
He
was the coach.
Let me just help you out and tell you why they kept him.
Okay, tell me.
This is my theory.
Okay.
Dylan Raiola.
Well,
I think that's the theory, man.
So Dylan Raiola committed to Ohio State.
Yeah.
Scott Frost and them kind of screwed that all up, right? And I think it was a good chance. Now, he's committed to Ohio State, though.
Yeah.
Does he break that commit to come to Nebraska?
I mean,
it's a good idea.
I mean, not in a sense. I mean, not to cross over to different sports. Doug McDermott was at Northern Iowa.
Yeah.
And he came.
With his dad, though.
That's right.
Yeah, I mean, you know, Matt Rhule was his pops. Now, this is his uncle.
Yeah.
This is his uncle, so yeah, maybe. I think it had more to do with cohesiveness.
Okay.
Okay, you don't bring anybody back from the old staff.
Right.
I think you have to have some stability.
Yeah.
And he's your stability guy.
Yeah.
And I also think So towards the end of the year,
yeah,
when we were talking whether or not Mickey Joseph should come back or not,
uh-huh,
people kept saying, you can't judge Mickey Joseph with this roster.
Yeah.
I say, can you really judge Donovan Raiola with this offensive line?
I agree, because he really didn't get a shot because he was kind of doomed from the beginning with the leadership of that too.
I mean,
look,
talent.
He had transfers,
yep,
and injured players.
He did.
He never, yep, had an opportunity, yeah, to get things going.
Now, you had a guy like Bryce Benhart's been here, I think, 4 years.
Right.
I believe Turner Corcoran's been here 4 years as well.
Yep.
You had a six-year guy, another six-year guy. You were obviously missing Teddy Prochazka, who would have been a starter.
Yep.
You were missing the kid from that transferred in from Colorado State, who ended up Nuoli, who was out for the whole season because he used performance-enhancing,
yep,
drugs.
Yep, yep.
So you're missing your left tackle, your left guard.
Yep.
So if they would have had that, maybe it's a different story.
Yeah.
I like Donovan Raiola.
Yeah.
I think Donovan Raiola can be a young. Here is why I think he kept him, though. I'm going to tell you why I think he kept,
okay,
him.
Okay, yeah.
The Dylan Raiola idea is great. But I think it's because there's a lot of principles that Matt Rhule likes from the NFL.
Yeah.
And Donovan Raiola spent most of his career in the NFL. And that's the blocking schemes he has. And
right,
that's what he knows. And I think he looks at that and he goes, I got a young coach,
yeah,
who I can help mold and groom,
right,
who understands the blocking principles I want from the NFL.
Yeah.
That's why he kept him. He likes having younger coaches.
Right.
Because he wants to be a part of it. And older coaches sometimes, if you're constantly sticking your nose in there as the head coach, they get annoyed.
Yeah.
Don't always be coming in my meetings. Don't be coming in my room.
That's true.
A young coach maybe doesn't say the same thing.
But the thing is, like, I mean, but if you look at things like there wasn't the line wasn't physical.
Nope.
The lack of reads on defense,
yep,
the pass blocking, you can say so much more.
Mm-hmm.
From the eye test of last year,
yep,
I'm not going to lie, I was shocked.
Mm-hmm.
But
well, a lot of people were.
But, I, yeah, mean, I always make this joke. It's like 51st dates every time I watch a Husker game, man. I'm going to give them a chance.
Memory-wise? You,
yeah.
Got short-term memory loss?
I'm going to give them a chance, bro.
Certainly a possibility. And
yeah.
I think when you look ahead, obviously, the portal is going to be big for everybody, right?
Yeah.
There's a couple positions. I think you need more wide receivers, and hopefully,
true,
you get a guy who's a legacy,
right?
Keegan Johnson, who comes,
yep,
in. You're probably going to need another running back.
Yep.
And you're certainly going to need offensive and defensive,
yeah,
line.
Yeah, yeah, right.
So
right,
that's where you got to be. If you look at the transfer portal in the Big Ten,
I mean, how many young men are hopping in the portal?
Like 1,000.
Right.
But just in terms of the Big Ten, and this is from Husker Online,
yeah,
On 3 Network, Maryland had the most in the Big Ten so far. They have 14,
wow,
into the portal. Wisconsin had 12. Now,
okay,
they obviously lost their coach,
yeah,
too.
Yeah, lost
their coach.
Yeah, right.
So that makes a lot of sense.
Right.
Nebraska had 11. Now it's 10 because,
yep,
Jamari
because
Butler came back.
Yep.
Right. So they're third most. And then you have Indiana.
Yeah.
And then you have Iowa with 8. Keegan,
yep,
Johnson probably being the biggest one there.
Yep.
So, and Minnesota with 7. Northwestern only 7, it makes sense. Michigan State with 6.
Yeah.
Rutgers is 6. Penn State is 5. But you know what? It's funny. You look at these teams, the best records. Penn State won 10 games.
Yep.
Ohio State obviously is
obviously
in the playoff,
yep,
only gave up 4.
Yep.
Illinois didn't, but they had a really good season, only have 3.
Yep.
Michigan with 3. Purdue's going to have more because of that coaching change with Jeff Brown, but they only have 3 as well. But you look at what Nebraska is.
Yeah.
They're basically tied for 3rd in terms of numbers of kids in the portal.
And maybe that's why Jamari Butler is coming back.
I think so.
I mean, yeah, if you honestly think about it.
I think O'Shawn Mathis saying he was going.
Yeah, 100%. Yeah, and Caleb Tanner also
going
too. You,
right,
know,
right.
I feel like he probably had an epiphany. And I got to say good for him because,
yeah, yeah, yeah,
he honestly – has gotten better every year.
He's come a long way.
He's come a long way, man.
Yeah. And he was light when,
yes,
he got here.
And, yeah, for the fact that, yeah, like, he sees the optimism of coming back,
mm-hmm,
I think he'll do well this year.
I do, too. And obviously still parts of the coaching staff to be hired.
Yeah.
The rumor was for a couple of weeks that Jake Peets,
oh, okay,
former Husker, who had been with a lot of good programs, he'd been at LSU,
yeah,
and they thought maybe after the firing at LSU of Ed Orgeron, he ended up being at the Rams,
yep,
the offensive side of the ball.
Yep.
And we thought maybe he would then, you know,
yep,
end up coming to Nebraska. Well, he's not. He's,
yeah,
actually going to stay there with the Rams, which makes sense. I mean, he's under a good offensive coordinator.
Right.
So, you know, he get to learn a little bit there. But he's not coming to Nebraska, so they still have to figure out what they're going to do quarterback coach-wise,
yeah,
and other ones. Come on, sit down.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, so we got there's a lot of work still to be done with that, and we'll talk more about that when we – but our guest is here now, Trey Alexander joining us, guard for the
My
Creighton
guy.
Blue Jays. How you doing, man? How you think you played tonight?
I didn't play.
Hold on a second. Let's get your
– Yeah.
Yep, go ahead.
I didn't play as good as I was hoping, but – tried to make a couple plays down the stretch to try to get my team back in it since Art was, you know, he had fouled out at that point. But, I mean, I just tried to play to win, so I'm not really worried about the shots going in or out. I'm still going to shoot the ball regardless because I put in the reps. So, I mean, I didn't shoot the best, but it is what it is.
Yeah, and I was kind of saying that before you came up here. You somebody I call a stat pecker, man, like all the way back to high school. I mean, your points is always there.
Yeah.
Rebounds, steals, assists, like that's what you do. I mean, how do you feel like ultimately, like, do you think you could have done better or do you feel like you left it all on the floor?
I definitely feel like I left it all on the floor. I feel like there's always, like, points where people can make shots and stuff like that. But in terms of giving out my effort, I feel like I gave every single thing I could give out there tonight. But, I mean, it was just a couple of plays down the stretch that didn't go our way. And, I mean, we had a chance to kind of expand the game in the first half, and I feel like that's when we kind of relaxed, and that's when they kind of took advantage of it. So,
Trey Alexander joining us here on Let It Fly Show. You were down 11. About 3.5 left, and you guys put the press on them. Can you talk a little about what you were doing defensively there, forced a 10-second and 5 turnovers?
Yeah, we were just trying to speed them up. We were trying to deny, you know, cause a couple turnovers and then try to just get some plays downhill early in the shot clock, and that's what we did. So, I mean, we really just – if we would have played like that the whole 40, I feel like the outcome would have been different. But I feel like at the end of the game, we played with a lot more grit and will to win. So.
Mm-hmm. What do you think the identity of this team is? The reason why I ask that is because we know.
Yeah.
You know, we can shoot. We know we bucket getters. But, like, what do you think the identity of the team is? Like, right now at this point versus who you thought you were when the season first started?
I feel like right now, even though that the season is going the way that we want it to go, I feel like – we just have a group of guys that want to win. I feel like we're winners. I feel like we play hard. I feel like at the end of the day, regardless of the outcome, everybody is going to give 100% out on the floor. And then we'll look at the score later. But like I said, I feel like everybody on our team plays hard and is willing to play their role.
Yeah, okay. Yeah.
Kalkbrenner was out tonight, obviously. I understand how he impacts you guys defensively. How does your offense change when he's not in the lineup?
We have to space out the court a lot more. Art playing the five. We tried to get him the mismatch that he wanted with them playing big.
He looked good, bro.
Yeah, he did. And I mean, as you've seen, like last year in the Kansas game, he was kind of able to take advantage of that. So, I mean, the court opens up for everybody else when Kalkbrenner's not in the game. But at the same time, I mean, man shooting like 70-something percent from the field and averaging like 16 points. So you got to kind of take it and give what you can. So, I mean, but – the court opened up a lot for everybody else, but you know we definitely missed a big fella tonight for sure.
Do you think personally? I feel like I just don't think y'all like playing hard as you guys can defensively.
Yeah.
Do you feel the same?
I do feel the same. I feel like there's a couple instances where like we catch ourselves playing hard, but we're playing hard like in the wrong area, like. We're getting over the ball screen, but then we're, like, leaving a shooter.
That's what I'm trying to say.
Yeah, for sure. I feel like it's just little mishaps like that that are kind of getting us in these situations, which are actually the difference in a one-point game and, like, us winning the game. So,
So you dropped three. Just hearing you talk and just knowing you, like, outside of just right here on this podcast, like, I know the confidence is still there. What is Coach Mack's temperament for the team? Is it like eggshells? Is it like what's the vibe like leading up to this point before you guys drop today?
Yeah, Coach Mack is a very composed coach. He definitely believes in us. He gives us a feel of like we can play better, but we have to go out there and do the things that we need to do, control the things that we can control. I mean, shots aren't always going to fall. He tells us that all the time, but he tells us, like, at the end of the game, like, we have to know that we play harder than the other team.
Yeah.
And we hate to control the things that we can control. And I feel like in this game, we didn't really control the backboards like we wanted to, and that was the difference in the game. And, I mean, that was a big emphasis coming into this game. So, I mean, we had the right game plan. We just didn't follow through with it.
Now, Alexander joining us, guard from the Jays. Let me ask you how you developed from your first year to your second year. The best part of your game in terms of improvement from your first year to the year?
I would just say my confidence. I feel like last year when I had more pressure on me, when I had to have the ball in my hands, that's when I kind of played my best. And this year coming into a role of having to kind of fill a lot of offensive holes in the offense, I feel like that's when I kind of played my best. It's just the confidence area and me you know, knocking down the three better this year, a lot better. Almost like double the percentage that I shot last year. So, I mean, it's really just been the work this offseason and me trying to just take my game to that next level confidence-wise and kind of helping space out the offense.
Yeah, that's kind of where I was going with this. I was going to ask, like, as I watch you, I feel like I'm not going to say you hadn't been yourself. Yeah. I'm not one when I look at you. If your offensive points is not there, that doesn't speak to, like, the value, what you do across the board.
Yeah.
Do you feel like in the spurt of this last three games, do you feel like you hadn't been yourself, or do you think the team and you are just in this slump?
I would say it's a little bit of both. I would say I haven't been myself on the offensive end. I feel like there's definitely a way that I can play better on the offensive end for sure. But,
yeah,
I mean, like any other player, when you're having a slump, you get in the gym, and that's what I've been doing. Shots just aren't falling. That's just what it is right now. And, yep. I mean, it has nothing to do with what I'm doing outside of the game or anything like that. My preparation is still there. I'm still shooting just as many shots as I was but when I was playing good in the first six games. So, I mean, I'll take a lot of backlash for this,
yeah, for this
slump that we're in. But
yeah, respect.
I mean, like, it's a lot on me because I'm one of the leader on the team. But it's just, like, I put a lot on me, so that's just what it is.
Yep.
It's a business trip, obviously. But you are in Vegas.
Yeah.
Do anything fun? Are they taking you guys anywhere?
We haven't done anything so far.
I saw you guys practice yesterday. You just went back to the hotel.
Yeah, we all just went back to the hotel. Yeah. I mean, I'm just worried about getting back in the W column.
Sure.
Like,
yeah, right.
I mean, we can go to Vegas anytime we want to in the off season and stuff like that. But right now, in the middle of the season, like, we're on a 4-game losing streak. I'm going to my room, I'm watching film, trying to see which ways I can be better and try to get us out of this slump, and that's the biggest thing for me right now. Stuff like that excites me, but I'm more of like a person that's like kind of business first.
Yeah.
Yeah. How has Baylor changed the team?
Baylor changed the team in a multitude of ways. I think I said this at the beginning of the season, like, Baylor gives us like a point forward type of feel. Like, he can get the rebound. He rebounds the ball very well. I mean, he averages like almost 9-10 rebounds a game. And then he pushes the pace as soon as he gets the rebound. So, I mean, for me and R2 to be able to get out and get on those wings and be able to, you know, play downhill off of him, that's kind of plays to our advantage. So, I mean, and he spreads the floor great. I mean, last year he was like a 46% three-point shooter. And I feel like the stats will even themselves out as the season goes. But, I mean, he's a great shooter and he does a lot for us on both ends of the court.
Yeah, for sure.
What did Coach Max say after the game?
Yeah, I was about to say that.
What did he say in the locker room?
He was just telling us that, like, the reason that they were in the game was because that we let them. Like, it was things that we knew were going to happen. They played the way that we knew they were going to play. We had a great game plan for it.
The preparation. We watched the practice.
Yeah.
You guys prepared.
Yeah, we said before you came up here, bro, we felt like Mac and the staff did everything that they can do to put you on a position to win.
Yeah.
So we just kind of felt like it's more so on y'all to kind of work that out amongst yourselves. You as a leader, but also as other guys to step up. The bench.
Yep.
You see guys slow roasting in practice. You see guys wanting to play. They got that chip and things like that. What's up with the bench? Why do you think the bench hasn't like had the whole coming out party yet? I mean, you got a few guys, but
I would personally say that, like, when guys come off of the bench, it's kind of like in spurts. So I feel like sometimes people get out there and they feel like they can't really get their rhythm. Like, they play like two and a half minutes and then coming right back out. I mean, and Mac plays his starters a lot because I definitely feel like he feels like the starters are like kind of those guys that bring like the energy and things like that. But
100%.
I definitely feel like our bench is good enough to compete with a lot of other people's bench. I just feel like, and throughout the midst of the game, like, the starters haven't been playing the way that they need to play for the bench to kind of get their rhythm and things like that.
Yeah.
So I really blame it. I really blame it mostly on the starting five that the bench hasn't really been able to get their rhythm, because
that's a way to look at it.
Yeah,
okay.
The closer that the game is, I feel like the less that the bench is able to like
get
their rhythm.
Yeah, you need to put them
in
a position to do their job.
Yeah, exactly.
Respect. I understand that.
Trey Alexander joining us here. You get a choice to go a lot of different places.
Yeah.
You chose to come to Omaha from Oklahoma City. Has it been what you thought it would be?
Yeah, for sure. I mean, I really came here knowing that it was going to be a lot of isolation. That's kind of what I liked. I feel like if I would have went to a bigger city or things like that, I would have got a lot more distracted. I wouldn't have kind of put my head down and been able to just work on my game. And I feel like Omaha has changed my game a lot in terms of being able just to realize how much I need to focus to get to that next level. So, I mean, my freshman year was an eye-opener, and then me being able to just focus and work on my game throughout that middle of the summer definitely changed my game a lot coming into this season. And so now, I mean, it's just in terms of me being in Omaha, like, I love the people. They're great people. They always support us everywhere we go. Yeah. Even we were down by 11 with 3 minutes left, everybody's still clapping. They're screaming.
There's a lot of blue in here tonight.
Exactly.
Man, bro. Yeah, it was crazy.
Yeah. And, I mean, I respect everybody in Omaha. I love the people of Omaha. I mean, Omaha is always like a second home to me because of the way that they treat their players and the way that they treat us, like, give us like a celebrity feel in Omaha.
For
it's
sure.
great.
Yeah. Yeah. This is my last question for you. Your boy Freddie King. Oh, it cut me off?
He lost his mic for a second.
I lost my mic.
You're
I'm back. Okay. Your boy Freddie King, you got to start today. What did that mean to him from like your eyes? And what do you think him starting does for him moving forward?
Yeah. I mean, everybody, you know, everybody wants to start. And I feel like Freddie is one of those people that, like, when he gets it all together, he's going to be a problem because he's very super athletic. He's very, like, springy. He can finish well around the rim. He blocks shots at a high level. He does everything like that. But when Fred is able to, like, you know what spots he has to be in on defense and realize that he's not just going to be able to make up for everything with athleticism, then I feel like Fred's going to be, like, he's going to be a next-level player. And I feel like this game of him starting is going to be a big confidence boost for him for the next two games. And
for
I feel like it's going to be one of those things, like, you know, where a player finally gets their rhythm and things like that. I think he'll be able to come big for us down the stretch because of this stretch right here.
Man, it sounds like you're mimicking us.
Last question. Got to flush this pretty quickly. You got to come back on Monday and play Arizona State.
Yeah.
Have you seen anything from them yet, or are you guys going to be watching tape on them tomorrow?
We're definitely going to be I'll be watching the little – tonight. Tape on them tonight for sure. See kind of what their guard play is like and like what they how their style of play is, and probably getting with Mac and like having a conversation with him.
Because
I mean, at the end of the day, we're just trying to get out of this slump, and I feel like when we get back in that win column, things are going to kind of take off from us. I think that we'll be able to go on a crazy win streak, just in my opinion, because I feel like when we're able to string it all together and like find that defensive niche, everybody finds that rhythm on offense, I feel like when things get clicking the way that we know how, I feel like we'll be very hard to beat down the stretch, and I feel like a big – I'm just saying it now that I feel like a big win streak is coming when we go into conference play for sure.
Right. Get some rest, man.
Yes, sir. Thank
you,
guys.
My man.
Appreciate it.
Way to play.
Thank you, guys.
Appreciate it, man. Thank you. Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Trey Alexander, Creighton guard, joining us here following Creighton's loss 83-80. Mick Ultra Arena here in Vegas. Play again on Monday, 6 o'clock start, Vegas time, 8 o'clock start in Omaha. You got to – I knew you've been a part of, obviously, losses – mentally, you just got to kind of go, okay, it's over.
Yeah, you literally.
I just, it's over.
Literally.
There's nothing I can do about it.
Literally have to
I will tell
let
you, fans hold on to it more than you guys hold on to it. Fans hold on to it, and they're like miserable all night and all day tomorrow. You guys can just turn it off.
And the crazy thing is fans see it differently, but look at his temperament, though.
Yeah.
He's still locked in.
He's got to be.
Yeah. It doesn't matter about what actually happened. He put it on his shoulders and holding himself accountable. He a cool dude, bro.
Yeah, he took a lot of blame. It's the bench.
Yeah.
Not having Ryan Kalkbrenner.
Right.
Obviously getting Kalum in foul trouble turned the game.
And rebounding.
Yeah, all that turned the game a lot. Last thing before we wrap the whole thing up. The game before this, we talked about it, was Cal State Fullerton fell to Southern Utah. In that game, former Central Eagle, Latrell Reitzel Jr., big game, had 20 points, led everybody in scoring.
My God, Trelly.
Fell short, lost the game, but looked good out there.
Yeah, he did. Shout out to Trelly, man. Shout out to his team. Trelly's one of those guys who he just has a motor. He doesn't stop. He's very aggressive offensively.
Oh, yeah.
And he does whatever he has to do to make it happen.
Yeah. Not every guy from Omaha and from Nebraska has to go to Creighton, Omaha, or Nebraska. But too many of these guys leaving the state.
Man.
This dude should be playing at some – he should have been wearing red or blue.
Come on, Matt
at
Rule.
At a minimum.
Come on.
Fred Hoiberg or whoever.
Hoiberg.
Somebody.
Yeah, somebody.
This guy should have played here. And then John Tonji's another guy. We didn't talk a lot about
Colorado
John Tonji.
State.
He's averaging 14.5 points. It's another guy that should have been here.
Yeah, right.
I know not everybody can go, but these are guys that should have been here.
St. Thomas. Chucky Hepburn. We can keep going.
Well, Chucky. Could you imagine – we didn't talk about that. Nebraska plays Purdue.
Yeah.
And they played Purdue. They were down at one point.
Talk about
15,
it. Talk about it.
Came all the way back. Had a chance to take the lead a couple times. Ends up getting it into overtime. There's a play late.
Yeah.
So Nebraska's down one. It's around midcourt. Obviously, they got a foul because it's under the shot clock. They go to foul. They don't foul. The guy loses the ball first.
Purdue player loses the ball, Nebraska's going to get it. They call the foul anyway. It was one of those where the ref anticipated the call.
Oh, and blew the whistle.
Instead of allowing the call to actually happen. That changed everything.
That would have tied the game.
Well, they were down one.
Oh,
Nebraska
could
have taken the lead.
Oh, wow.
They could have gone up one. They could have gone up two at that situation. But instead, they go down. Purdue gets the foul call, goes and makes both free throws.
Yeah.
And then Nebraska misses a three to tie.
Yeah.
Game ends. But they fought hard.
Man.
It would have been the first time they beat a top five team since 2011.
Wow.
So, you know, talking 12 years.
Yeah.
You could have got that done. But or 10 years. You could have 12 years. Yeah, you could have got that done. But 11 years. Add. Anyway, so you look at the way they played.
Yeah.
Imagine if Chucky Hepburn was on that team.
I'm trying to tell
if
you,
if that
man.
Was their point guard.
Man.
With how hard that
Every
team
time
plays.
I watch him play, I see him in blue, I see him in red.
I know.
But Nebraska red.
Nebraska red. He's such a physical player, and that's the team they have now.
Yes.
When Fred was recruiting, when Chucky was coming out, he was looking for shooters.
Yeah.
It was a different system than he's running now. Now, tough guys.
Oh, my God.
Get to the free throw line. Play defense. Chucky would have fit in perfectly.
He's a floor general.
He
would have controlled the offense, controlled the tempo.
I know.
It'd be totally different. And I caught some of the game, and I looked at the stats after. And
Kisi Tominaga?
Oh, man, off the bench. He was hooping.
He was hooping. He again led Nebraska in scoring. Hit a big shot at the end of the game, and then another big shot in overtime to tie the game. So he played really tough.
And be honest, him playing like that thing had 19. He doing what he was doing was him feeding off of Purdue actually shooting. But they shot pretty. They didn't shoot as well as they wanted to shoot today. Mm-hmm. And in Nebraska, when I watched them play, they dang near triple team the center.
They had to.
The
kid's 7'4".
Before he even caught the ball.
He's 7'4".
And he still had a triple-double almost.
Derek Walker played as – now, he's given up 7 inches to this guy.
Yeah.
He outweighs him probably.
Right.
But he's given up 7 inches. And you look at the way he played, some of those stats for the game – rebounding-wise, you'd think that Nebraska would have gotten dominant on the boards because of how big in a lot of places.
Yeah.
Two rebound difference.
Two?
Purdue had 46, Nebraska had 44.
And the difference of the game was that call you talked about.
That was the difference in it. Nebraska would have the ball
at
midcourt going back the other way. And by the way, they'd had numbers, too.
Yeah.
They would have had numbers come back the other direction.
Yeah.
Maybe they make the shot, maybe they don't. They missed a lot of big shots late, but they had a chance to win the game.
You got to give credit to Hoiberg and what he's doing.
Mm-hmm.
Those players have automatically they came together. They're buying in. They're buying in.
Yep.
And I think it helped that they actually beat Creighton.
Confidence.
You know, the confidence is just so high.
Nebraska offensive rebounded them 19-14.
Man.
Points in the paint. As big as Purdue is, 24-22 points in the paint.
Oh, ridiculous.
I mean, they held their own against one of the best teams in the country.
And I know people don't like to do moral victories.
I know you don't, everyone, yeah.
But in the case of that game against the fourth best team in the country, you can go nowhere but up from there.
Yeah, I mean, it's going to be a tough road in the Big Ten. We know how good the Big
we
Ten
know
is
how
overall.
Big Ten is tough, man.
It's going to be a lot of work for them.
Right.
But just to play this well,
to
be right there, have a chance to win, it'd been great to get over the hump, obviously. But this is a team, like you said, they have bought in. They really have bought
in. And Derek Walker is a leader. I mean,
he is.
He's a walking double-double.
Yeah.
He had the COVID year.
Mm-hmm.
He was a part of the Sweet 16 run when he was at where was he at?
I always forget where he goes to school.
He was a sophomore in the Sweet 16. Tennessee.
Tennessee, thank you.
He went to Tennessee.
Yes.
Yeah, he was at Tennessee.
Oh, yeah, that was a good team.
And now, with his leadership is within his play. He let his game do the talking.
Yeah,
100%.
He's such a good player.
It was a good game.
A couple other things before we go.
Yep.
One, Larry Asante, former safety for Nebraska.
Okay.
I love this because at first it felt like maybe not all the former players and folks were in on Matt Rhule.
Word.
But it seems like it's changing. Larry Asante is now an assistant coach at Coffeyville Junior College.
Yep, okay.
He says, I'm about to go hard for Nebraska football and send all my JUCO athletes that can make immediate impact to Lincoln.
Dang.
Hashtag GBR, hashtag Coffeyville, hashtag black shirts, all that stuff. The guys are sitting, I think you listen to him talk, like today during halftime or Saturday during halftime of the game, Matt Rhule was introduced to the crowd.
Yep.
Done it before.
Let's go, Jays. And that's another thing I was going to say. He had that crowd rocking against Purdue.
He did a great job out there. He said, this is everything for us. This means a lot. Try to get this team back. People buy into what he's saying.
Say, let's go Huskers.
GBR. Hashtag
yeah,
GBR.
Go Big Red.
And then last thing.
Bleed blue, I guess.
I spent a full 2 hours watching Creighton soccer yesterday. I don't watch a lot of soccer, but yeah. I watched it. They fought their asses off.
Yeah.
They end up losing 3-2.
Sure.
They had a couple bad breaks.
But to go to the
things.
College Cup, though,
they
man.
They go to the College Cup. You're losing the semifinals. Syracuse played. Syracuse is one of the best teams in the country.
Yeah.
Number one seed.
What usually happens is when you lose to an elite team like that, they go on to win it all.
I wouldn't be surprised.
Yeah.
I would not be surprised.
Yeah, and I would actually feel better about it.
I hope it is Syracuse, for sure. I hope it is. But great fight. Props to Jays, yep. soccer, Johnny Torres, and all those guys of everything they did, because it's to get to this point from what people expected of them is incredible. And also, Heisman Trophy, congratulations to Caleb Williams at USC. I voted for Max Duggan.
Yeah.
That's who I voted for.
But we kind of figured, though.
I'm a huge Max Duggan fan.
Yeah.
But Caleb Williams, 68% of USC's offense.
I mean,
put over 4,000 total yards.
Yep.
Fell short at the end.
Right.
Those other three guys,
yeah.
they're all in the college football playoff.
Exactly.
He's the only one not. But he gets the Heisman Trophy.
Exactly,
so,
yeah. Would you rather have a Heisman?
I'd rather win a national championship. A Heisman changes you so much so, it changes your actual name. You go from being Eric Crouch to Heisman Trophy winner Eric Crouch.
Okay.
Okay? So it changed you. But you can never replace a national championship.
Amen.
And
yeah.
I'd take a national championship over a Heisman Trophy any day.
You know, Carmelo Anthony wanted the ring and wanted the points and the money versus a ring with LeBron.
But he got that freshman title at Syracuse. Go Orange, baby. He got that. There's no doubt about that. I grew up a Syracuse fan.
Yeah,
so,
man.
We'll be back with the pregame show on Monday. Game starts at 6 here locally, 8 o'clock in Omaha. 90 minutes before the game is when we'll come on. We're going to have Mike Miller on.
Mike Miller, man.
The man behind Let It Fly
Sports Bar.
We'll
Legend.
Chat with Matt Miller. Mike Miller, two
back-to-back
championships.
Yep. LeBron
this is a guy
James.
Who's played all this, have a hell of a career, played at Florida.
One of the greatest shooters to play in the NBA.
Certainly, definitely one of the best from South Dakota.
There's no doubt about that.
So catch us 90 minutes before the Creighton game on Monday, and we'll have a bunch to talk about from the weekend, of course.
Yep. Hey. When you see me, say what's up out there, Let It Fly fans. Man, we love you.
I'm Michael Severe. He's Josh Jones. We're back. More Let It Fly show brought to you by Omaha Steaks and Let It Fly Sports Bar, opening up Memorial Day weekend in the Capital District. We're back on Monday.